great to be with you. I'm Derry Long. I'm on the staff at Journey Church down in Bozeman, Montana. And I'm also an overseer, so I get together with pastors from about six churches in our region, which includes Adams. So every so often, about a half dozen of us gather here at Helena up in Adams' august office, filled with all the great tombs of wisdom that he has. And we just kind of share what's going on in our lives. And so it's been a terrific thing to be part of his life and to be here with you. When I was a little younger, I was involved in church planting and planted two churches in Iowa, and I have great regard for the people who pour their lives out into a very entrepreneurial and risk-taking venture, and the kind of setting where God has to show up. We often put ourselves into positions in life where we'd like God to show up, but he doesn't have to show up because we maintain an environment that's manageable. When we get into an environment where it's not actually manageable unless God shows up, that always requires something of us. So good job, and great to see you. This is a terrific building, though with the kind of weather outside, I think we shall not be long-winded. So out of this interaction that we have together with Adam and Brian Hopkins down at Journey and some of the other guys, one morning we had a session where we shared our theological journeys. And in the course of that, I shared my own theological journey. I don't ever remember not being in church. My mom was a Sunday school superintendent. She played piano in the worship service. I could have been born in the back pew. I have no memory of not being part of a church culture. 2 days ago, I turned 62, and in that entire time, I've been part of a church culture. Because of that, I've been living in the church world for virtually all my 62 years. And in the living of that world, there are certain aspects about the world of church. There's about 450,000 churches in the United States. And there are certain aspects about that culture that I became puzzled with and then disenchanted with. And it became the, at least in part, the impetus for a theological journey in my life. And Adam asked me if I would share today what I shared in that group setting that was part of my theological journey. I'm not trying to impose this journey on you. This is only my testimony of my journey, of how to make sense of truth and what the Scripture says and how the church world operates. If you've not been part of the church world, this might be informative to you. If you are, maybe you've had struggles with some of the tensions that are part of that world. So if you choose that your journey is going to be somewhere else, that's fine with me. I'm just sharing what my journey has been. Let's look at some scripture first. First from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul is speaking. And he says, some of us are Jews, some are Gentiles, some are slaves, and some are free. But we have all been baptized into one body by one Spirit. And we all share the same Spirit. Yes, the body has many different parts, not just one part. If the foot says, I am not a part of the body because I am not a hand, that does not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear says, I am not part of the body because I am not an eye, would that make it any less a part of the body? If the whole body were an eye, how would you hear? Or if the whole body were an ear, how would you smell anything? But our bodies have many parts, and God has put each part just where he wants it. How strange a body would be if it had only one part. Yes, there are many parts, but only one body. The eye can never say to the hand, I don't need you. The head can never say to the feet, I don't need you. And then from Proverbs chapter 11, verse 14, there is safety in a multitude of counselors. One of the disturbing parts of many people who look in on the church industry of 450,000 churches is that while it suggests to the world that one of its primary values is love, they see the church world as highly adversarial. It's not like we're all telling everybody else they're not going to get to heaven. But many parts of the church are telling the other parts of the church that they would be better off if they were like us. And so they watch this adversarial relationship develop between churches, between denominations, which are groups of churches that have similar ethnic, governmental, or doctrinal beliefs. And as they watch this adversarial relationship, and they watch this as it is compared to the scripture, behold how they love one another, they're confused. It isn't like they don't expect people to have opinions, but they don't understand this kind of adversarial model in the midst of all of this relational love rhetoric that exists. And so they watch this huge industry. And while many people come into the world of the church and they find Jesus Christ, there are legions of people who have become so disenchanted with the Christian world that they simply move to the sidelines. It doesn't always mean that they abandon faith in Christ, but it does mean that they become highly passive, or even worse, not involved at all. You can look in on the church and you see this myriad of doctrines and ideas. You don't have to go any further than the book of Revelation to begin to study doctrines like premillennialism, postmillennialism, amillennialism. Then there's the view of the rapture, where the church of Jesus Christ is taken out of the world before the tribulation, but you have the pre-tribulation rapture and the post-tribulation rapture and the mid-tribulation rapture. And then we can dip our toe into baptism. And many parts of the church baptize adults only. And many parts of the church believe that children can also be baptized. And it's not just who gets baptized, but it's how they get baptized. And so some of them pour, and some sprinkle, and some dunk. And some believe baptism is an entirely spiritual activity, and there's actually no physical event that occurs. Well, by the time I'm looking at all the issues around raptures and all the issues around baptism, and then there's the principle of sanctification, which is about the growth of the believer, and there are huge parts of the church that believe that once you're a believer in Christ, that you grow progressively towards Christ-likeness, and there's another part of the church that believes that after you've become a believer, you'll have a crisis experience and a once-for-all type of event, and then there's others that believe that during this progressive growth, you have a series of crises. And interestingly enough, in every position, they pile up scripture to support their view. So when somebody says to me, yes, but I believe the scripture, that's not quite adequate. Because theology book after theology book after theology book can be used to support any one of these views that I have just enumerated. And that says nothing about using the scripture to validate whether a church should use one kind of music or another kind of music or one kind of order or another kind of order or one kind of government or another kind of government. Well, you see where we're at. I finally came to the place in my journey where I was not willing to hold a position if it required that 50 to 60 or more percent of everybody else had to be wrong. That can't be. That can't be how this works. Like, all right, it'd be great. You would get to heaven, but you'll get there better, healthier, wiser if you got there believing what I believe. Really? I'm German, so there's a nice feel to that. But there's something then that denigrates everybody else. Like, they don't have as good a mind as I have, or they're not as good a Bible student as I am. Or really, does my view require the denigration of everybody else who's not living in the vicinity the theological vicinity that I live in? So I begin to ponder these things. And it resulted in this kind of consequence in my personal journey. And I actually use a little diagram that's got a roof and three pillars and some foundation. And we're just going to kind of walk through that. Now, let me repeat again. This is my journey. I'm not insisting it's your journey. It's how God has spoken into my heart to help me make sense of both what to believe and yet how to love and appreciate the broader body of Jesus Christ. Now, in the Christian world, there's a branch. By branch, I don't mean a denomination. I mean a certain segment of Christianity that's called evangelical. Evangelical is usually conservative Christianity, and it has two great foundations. It's built on two things. And there's all kinds of other things that are part of that foundation, but there are two things that are fundamental, that are non-negotiable parts of evangelical Christianity. One is the authority of Scripture, and the second is the finished work of Jesus Christ upon the cross. That everything that God did and is doing in this world, he is doing because of Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son who is God, the work that Jesus did in coming to this earth, living his life, building up a church, dying on the cross, rising again, ascending to the Father, returning eventually. Finished work of Christ upon the cross. That's a non-negotiable element of the evangelical world, this part of Christianity. And the other is the authority of Scripture. That there are many ways that God speaks to us, but every way he speaks to us must come under the authority of the Scriptures. That the Scriptures are inspired by God. They are authoritative. They are reliable, dependable. There are many truths in this world that are beyond Scripture, but there is no truth in this world that is contrary to Scripture. And those two are fundamental pillars, non-negotiable pillars, absolute characteristics of the evangelical world. Well, you can usually get that far in without being too denigrating. But the next is, that's where we start, the whole thing starts falling apart. Now there are different nuances, but within evangelicalism there's three great strains of theology or church. One is the charismatic, the second is the Wesleyan, and the third are Calvinists. Now, This is where people start saying, well, they'll get to heaven, but I wish they were like me. Charismatics tend to emphasize the work of the Holy Spirit. They believe there's a great emphasis on the miracles and speaking in other tongues and freedom in style of worship. Those are just some aspects of the charismatic. The most common, maybe the most well-known charismatic denomination in the United States is the Assemblies of God. Wesleyans. Our evangelical heritage is Wesleyan. Wesleyan comes out of Methodism. And Methodism was a powerful force and still is a powerful force in Christianity. It is a historical fact that since the book of Acts until the recent outburst of charismatic fervor in Latin America, which has brought literally hundreds of thousands of people to Christ, that prior to that, the greatest move of the Holy Spirit since the book of Acts was the move of Methodism across the United States as the nation moved west. So much so that even in decline, there are still more Methodist churches in the United States than there are post offices. There was almost no small village or hamlet anywhere in the United States as the nation moved west that did not have a Methodist preacher preaching the gospel. Our background comes out of that. The third is Calvinist, which was a theological system that was founded by John Calvin in Europe. It was a time when most of Europe was deeply, deeply touched by Calvinism. Many of the great seminaries of the United States are Calvinist. Many of the great commentaries that are written on the scriptures are Calvinist. Well, perhaps the most common known charismatic denomination is Assemblies of God, and the most common known Wesleyan is the Methodist. Most, but not all, Baptists are Calvinist. Now, you know, there's a chance that within another decade, there'll be more Christians in Latin America than non-Christians, but it'll be mostly because of the move of the charismatic work in Latin America. You know, that causes me to work extra hard to have to feel like I'm superior to them. And if it's true that one of the greatest moves of the Holy Spirit in Christianity since the book of Acts was Methodism, if I'm not Methodist, it makes it difficult to say, well, you'd be better off if you were like me. And in my personal life, I've been deeply impacted by people from every one of those strains. I grew up in a Wesleyan denomination, in a Wesleyan church, who took me to Bible camp and to Sunday school, and I heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, and I gave my heart to Christ in great measure because of the impetus of that group. But the night I became a Christian was at a Lowell Lundstrom crusade in Williston, North Dakota. And he was an Assemblies of God evangelist who with his family had a band and they traveled all over the Midwest. And then I attended Bethel Seminary, which has Calvinist roots. It's General Conference Baptist in Minneapolis. And I heard one of the greatest series of talks I've ever heard in my life by Stephen Olford, who's a Calvinist Baptist, dead now, but pastored in New York. My life would be poorer. It would be more poverty-stricken if it had not been touched by people from each one of these strains of the evangelical world. Now, interestingly, you and I are made up of mind, will, and emotions. And though you might have a proclivity to emphasize one over the other, there's, in fact, no biblical basis for saying that one is more important than the other. That through my mind, my will, and my emotions, those all three of those become an avenue, a road through which God and His grace travels. But if you were to look at these three, the charismatics emphasize emotions, the Wesleyans emphasize the will, and Calvinists emphasize, now I use emphasis, I'm not saying that it's exclusive, Calvinists emphasize the mind. So if you hold up these three, it's kind of like holding up a diamond. And you begin to look at the different facets of the diamond, and as you look at the different facets of the diamond, you see different elements of truth. And if you just take one element out, you reduce your ability. I reduce my ability to fully appreciate the great scope of the nature and the work of Jesus Christ and His truth. So let me show you how that works in doctrinal. If there's mind, will, and emotions, let's take the doctrine of God. The charismatics, because of their emphasis on emotions, they emphasize the power of God. And the Wesleyans, they would emphasize the holiness of God. And the Calvinists, they emphasize the sovereignty of God. And I need all three of those to really fully appreciate the nature of God. But just as interesting to me, our strengths are almost always our weaknesses as well, because our strengths blind us because we're so strong. So a charismatic, emphasizing emotion and the power, can easily slip into sensationalism. Where if God doesn't show up and I jump a pew, God wasn't really there. The still small voice isn't quite enough. And Wesleyans, because of their emphasis on the will and personal responsibility, very easy to get into legalism. Where walking with Christ is a matter of ticking it all off. I got my list of 25 things. You know, lists are kind of a hard thing if that's how you come to Christianity. I mean, I can start making lists, and I say, well, you know, I was reading the Bible today, and I came across the Beatitudes, and boy, I made a list. I'm gonna build these Beatitudes into my life, and then I'm reading a little more, and oh, I come across the fruit of the Spirit. Well, I want the fruit of the Spirit, and so I start listing all the fruit of the Spirit, and I'm going to add that. And so, I don't know, what are there, 8 or 9 Beatitudes, and now I got the fruit of the Spirit, another 8 or 9 of those, and I'm up to 18, and I'm reading the Scripture some more, and then there's the gifts of the Spirit. I want to be fruitful in my service to the Lord, and so I have the gifts of the Spirit, and then I'm reading Peter, and he says, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and knowledge self-control, and I don't know, what's there, 7 or 8 things there? So I got, what do I got, 8 or 9? I add another 8 or 9, I add another 15, and now I add another 7 or 8, and what am I up to? Oh, I got a list about 30, 35. You know, if I keep doing that, well, I got the disciplines. I need to be reading my Bible, and I need to be praying, and I need to be giving, and I need to be sacrificing. And so I got another 5. And hey, if you're a woman, you're in luck, because you can read about the virtuous woman in Proverbs 31, and there's a good 20 or 30 things there. So, whoo, your list is already up to 60 or 70 things. And by the time your list or mine gets up to 70 or 80 things, every time I show up to church, my fundamental feeling is guilt. Because I'm always going to be able to find something that I'm not doing too well at. See, lists aren't particularly helpful. So Wesleyan theology, which focuses on the will and personal responsibility, can easily end up into legalism, rob you all of your joy, and legalism also always results in a judgmental spirit towards other people. Because if I got to keep my 50, you better be keeping your 50. Because you're not going to have any more fun than I'm having. This thing, if we all make our way to heaven. Calvinism, with its emphasis on the mind. One person said to me once, well, I think Calvinism truths because they have so many Bible scholars. I said, they're not true because they have so many Bible scholars. They have so many Bible scholars because they focus on the mind. And so many of the great commentaries on the Old and New Testament are written by Calvinists because they respect that part of how God created us and how it's to be used to glorify Him. But if I focus on sovereignty, I can easily slip into irresponsibility. Hey, whoever's going to be saved is going to be saved. So I'm not sure I got to work that hard. And besides that, if I'm chosen, I'm chosen. It's God's sovereign. He's going to do whatever He wants to do. Now, every one of these three camps would say that I am simplifying their system. But every system has a fundamental practical byproduct. And I'm talking about the fundamental practical byproducts. So every group's strength is also their weakness. Now, what led me to start looking at the church world this way? Well, I started looking into each of these groups, and I thought, you know, they have certain things in common. Number one, they all are filled with people who are believers, who love the Lord, and who are deeply devoted to His cause. Every one of them. Calvinists are not more spiritual than Wesleyans, and Wesleyans are not more spiritual than charismatics. Second, they're fundamentally all working with the same Bible. Not like that they're working off different books. Three, the Lord says that the Holy Spirit will lead us into all truth. And that promise includes the believers in all three of these groups. How can I be saying of one whole group, well, about 80% of what you believe is wrong, if I actually believe that they love the Lord, they have the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is going to lead them into truth? Every one of them has this promise. For they all have stellar Bible scholars. I could talk to you about the great scholars in every one of these groups. I've already mentioned the Calvinists, but one of the greatest Isaiah scholars in the world is John Oswalt, and he's a Wesleyan. I could say the same about scholars in the charismatic tradition. They all have great scholars. And yet, though they have believers deeply devoted to Christ, working off the same Bible with the promise of the Holy Spirit to lead them into all truth, and good scholars, they end up with different conclusions. So I either got to decide they're dumb, not really a relational strength there, or I have to believe that God meant it that way. That he's not trusting anybody with the whole picture. He meant it that way so that we would depend on one another. And instead, too often the church has said, you might get to heaven, but you'd be better off if you were like me. No, that takes part of the picture away. That's like cutting off a chunk of the photo. Now I need facets of the diamond. I need every aspect of the kingdom. And God meant his church to show all these aspects. These aren't faults. This is not a weakness. This is a strength of the universal church of Jesus Christ. So it produces three things. It produces humility. Humility is, I need you. You know, I read being 62 now, ineligible for Social Security, I read something that was encouraging to me. For some years, they've been believing that by the time you reach about 40, your ability to increase your mental power starts to diminish. You know, you're kind of like this, and it's leveling off a little bit, and then here's 40, and then 50. But researchers at Harvard have found that that's not actually the case. That if you're going to be healthy, there's actually three learning stages. And if you continue to go through these three stages, it actually enables your brain to continue to learn and to grasp. Embrace things. Stage one of learning is the socialized stage. That's where the things I believe are mostly I believe in because my parents have taught me, the church I grew up has taught me, the social culture I'm part of, and I embrace that truth. The second stage is the individualized stage. Usually it occurs in the last half of high school and in college where I start owning what I believe. And I may end up believing about 80% of what I've been taught. And I may augment that with 20% that's now fresh with me given my new life experience. But whatever it is I'm believing, I'm starting to own it as mine. I don't believe it just because somebody else told me. Then there's a third stage. That's actually the stage where we're able to step outside of our own personal system and we're able to look at it. Well, we look at other systems. And we can see the gaps in our system. And we can see value in other people's system, even if we don't believe the entire system that they have. We see that there are elements of that system that have validity and value to me. Now, here's my gripe with the Church of Jesus Christ. If these three stages are essential for personal growth, we have a tendency to try to freeze people into stage one. We're a telling culture. You come, I'm going to tell you what to believe, and if you really grasp it, I'm going to praise you for being such a good Christian. But don't talk back. Don't start telling me you've got Calvinist friends. If I want you to grow, I must give you the freedom to step outside of the system I'm giving you and view that system and see its gaps as well as the value of systems that you or I may not fully embrace. That is an act of maturity. And sometimes we get nervous. Humility. See, it generates humility. I'm fundamentally Wesleyan, but I need charismatics and I need Calvinists to show me parts of God that I don't get otherwise. The second thing that comes. Tension. I don't mean tension like I'm nervous. I mean tension like a cable that holds a bridge up. There's energy in tension. But almost every theological system tries to get rid of all the tension. I'll give you an example. I'm not a big fan of predestination. From my Wesleyan background, I think God gives us choice. Whosoever will may come. And so I think you and I get to be part of, in a relational dynamic, each part has to be able to choose. And so there's a relational dynamic of my being able to choose. And the doctrine of predestination at least suggests that God chooses who will be saved and who will be lost. But having said that, I don't see how else I could describe the conversion of Paul. God just picked him out. So he still had to choose. Oh, yeah. If God shows up on a street I'm walking on, blinds me, say, oh, yeah, no, Lord, let me think about this. I mean, really? See the tension there? Why do we always want to get rid of the tension? And I'll tell you why, at least partly. Evangelicals, more than anybody, are in love with sureness. I know less about the Bible today than I knew 30 years ago. Now, there are some things today I know more surely than I've ever known. But that pool of things is a lot smaller than it used to be. I wish I was still as smart as I was when I was 30. I was so sure. And you know that that's one thing a lot of people outside of the church dislike about us. And we just go gallivanting along, just not only into our own theological systems, but we carry that into politics and everything else, and we're just so sure. Really? I've decided that the people who are so sure all the time are all so sure just because they have an emotional need to be sure. It's not because everything's that sure. Now, I'm not trying to tell you and I shouldn't be sure about some things, but there's a lot of stuff I'm not so sure about. And it deepens my faith. It doesn't disintegrate it. See, there's tension. And the church, with the charismatic and the Wesleyans and the Calvinists, generate this tension. And there's energy in the tension. It makes us look at all the different facets and the angles and the issues. That God wants that tension. And then there's individual purpose. So you can say, well, then it doesn't matter what I believe. Oh, yes, it does, because if I grew up and if I've committed myself to a Wesleyan view, the rest of the church needs this emphasis on personal responsibility and the will and the holiness of God. And I bring that to the church, all the while letting the other parts of the church bring to me the truth that they carry. And then, you know, just because of how we are made, different people need different systems. And there are some people who are not going to be that healthy in a Calvinist system just because of their personal history, their family of origin, their temperament type, the experiences that they've had. They need a particular environment in order to thrive. And can I give them that? So where does that leave me? Well, the scripture says, I see through a glass darkly. This side of heaven, I don't see very well. And all of this helps me to see better because I'm letting more people, there's safety in a multitude of counselors. I'm letting more people help me understand the nature of God and the ways he works. I'm not able to say, I don't need you. No, I got my little system. I got my three volumes of theology, and I got my study Bible. And no, God's speaking through them too. That helps me. It keeps me safe. Word safe means the ability to avoid peril or harm, because I don't end up out of balance. And heresy isn't the absence of truth. Heresy is truth out of balance. Heresy, if there was no truth at all to a heresy, it would have no threat at all. And so when I began to let the Lord speak into my life through the entire scope of his church, it creates an umbrella of safety, a roof of safety, because I began to see truth and reality. I began to see what's really going on in a much thorough, clear way. And I can sit down, though I am Wesleyan in my fundamental background, with someone who's Calvinist, and someone else who's a charismatic, and I can utter up a prayer to Jesus Christ about how grateful I am that they are not only part of the Church of Christ, but that they are part of my life. And I'm the richer for that. In the book of Hebrews, the scripture talks about so great a cloud of witnesses. And for me, in my theological journey, this is my great cloud of witnesses that bear witness to the truth of Jesus Christ and the truth of Scripture, the truth of the ways of God in a much broader, fuller, and deeper way than I would have ever been able to comprehend had I stayed right here. I could have gotten to heaven staying right here, but it wouldn't have made sense of a lot of other stuff that's part of the kingdom. That's my theological journey. That's where I'm settling at this stage in my life. It doesn't have to be your journey. I'm not imposing this system on you or saying this has to be where you're at. But it allows me, for my own life, to have a deep and abiding and a humble and a learning posture within this great cloud of witnesses that you and I get to be part of. Why don't we set our things aside and bow our heads as we finish up this morning? If there's something in your own heart that's surfaced during this season of time, maybe you've been resisting something of the work of Christ because you felt the animosity that sometimes exists in the Christian church. And this was God's effort to try to lower that wall and say, listen, I'm at work in my church, and love is one of the banners that flies over it. And he wants you to allow this reality to be a motivator to shift your own devotion to Christ. And you could just communicate to him right where you're at this morning. Say, Lord, thank you. Thank you that there are so many people that you can bring into my life, so many perspectives of who you are and how you work. Thank you that there will be safety for me in this great cloud of witnesses. Father, we thank you for your kindness. Thank you for all the people who invest in our lives and all the perspectives and all the facets of the diamond. And we pray in Jesus' name that as we are loyal to Christ through all of these avenues, his name and his glory and his love will be lifted up. In Jesus' name.